Welcome back to Heroes of the Faith, a show where we are inspired by the lives of the saints so that we can become saints ourselves. I'm your host, Isaac Longworth, and today's saint is Saint Benedict. He is the patron saint of the entire continent of Europe, so if you've never heard of him before, you can probably guess that he's pretty important if the Pope decided to do that. But in today's show, we're going to learn about who this saint was, why he is such an amazing model of holiness, what he did in his life, and why he had such a huge impact on the church. Now, Benedict was born to a noble family in Norcia, Italy. He was born around the year 480, and he was raised in a Christian family. Now, as the child of noblemen, he was sent to excellent schools in Rome for further study. And in order for us to understand what happened to him in Rome, we need to understand a little bit of the historical background of what was happening during this time. Because in the late 400s, the Roman Empire, which was this massive empire that had ruled over huge parts of Europe, Africa, and Asia, was beginning to collapse. It had been strong, it had been ruled by the emperors, it had been a military force to be reckoned with, but as the years went on, it had become divided by political strife. Its cities and its people lived in decadence, and there was outside attacks happening on it from different barbarian tribes because they saw the collapse of the massive Roman Empire as an opportunity for raiding and pillaging. And so this empire, which had lasted for over 1,000 years, was beginning to crumble. And this caused major social upheaval. In fact, it's hard for us to imagine what it was like for the people to go through this because Rome had been the authority. It had been the central government. It had been the empire that had made the laws, that had made everything stick together. And all of this was coming apart. And so there was great social chaos during this time. Well, Benedict is in Rome in the midst of all of this. And he looks around himself and he starts to see the vice, the political intrigue, the vying for power, the worldliness and the lavishness of the people surrounding him. And he is disturbed and he becomes dissatisfied with the world and all of its trappings. And I don't know if you've ever felt like this yourself, but as Christians, we can sometimes feel this. We look out on the world with its scandals, with its political strife, with its selfishness, with its corruption, with the great divide between rich and poor. We see all of this and we can become dissatisfied, which is healthy because we're not made for this world forever. We know that this world is passing away and we are living for heaven. But Benedict was experiencing this in his soul. And as a result, Benedict decided to leave it all behind. He made this radical choice to leave Rome, to leave the world behind, to follow after God. And so he leaves his studies, he leaves his rich inheritance, his family name, he leaves the city to go and live in the country with his former childhood nurse. Now, I'll tell you a little bit of a humorous but embarrassing story of when I was a kid. When I was little, maybe 7 or 8 years old, I loved to read the lives of the saints. And I was reading about Saint Benedict at one point, and I loved Saint Benedict. I wanted to be like him. And when I was around 8 or 9 years old, I'm not sure the exact age, but another little girl came up to me about the same age, and she professed her undying love for me. She told me of her plans that we were going to grow up and get married together. And she said, you know, what do you think about this? Well, I had the life of Saint Benedict in my mind at that point in my life as a young child. And I told her, I don't think this whole marriage thing is going to work because like Saint Benedict, I am going to flee from the world and follow after God. And sorry, you're part of the world, so I can't really marry you. So I crushed her heart, crushed this young love before it even got a chance to start. So If you remember anything from this show, just remember that Saint Benedict saved me from a marriage proposal when I was 8 years old. But the real Saint Benedict, he began to live a life of holiness. He became known for it. People began to seek him out for advice, for prayers, and he actually worked his first miracle there. So his nurse had borrowed a neighbor's sieve and she had broken it by accident. She couldn't repair it. She couldn't bring it back to her neighbor in this condition. She was very distressed by it. So Benedict prayed over the sieve and restored it completely. And so his fame begins to spread. And so he decides to leave even that life, to leave even his nurse, to seek God in even more solitude, completely by himself as a hermit. Now you might be listening to this and thinking, why is Saint Benedict so obsessed with solitude? Why does he think that he has to become holy by being by himself? Well, there's a couple different reasons for this. One that we know very well is that the world is noisy. There's a lot of different voices that are competing for our attention all the time. And living in such a noisy world can drown out the voice of God. If we want to listen to the voice of God, we need to be able to tune out all the other voices. It's kind of like tuning into a radio. You can't listen to all the stations at once. And if you're in between stations, that's where you start to get static. You need to tune into one thing. And so sometimes it's easiest to listen to the silent, still voice of God in silence, closing out all the other voices. This is why in Psalm chapter 62, verse 5, it says, "For God alone my soul waits in silence." This is why the prophet Elijah in 1 Kings chapter 19, he goes to experience the presence of God, and there's wind, there's an earthquake, there's a fire, but God is in none of these things. But then it says, Elijah heard a still, small voice. And when he heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle because he recognizes the presence of God. So there's always been this tradition that seeking God in the silence is one way to be able to hear his voice. And this is what Benedict decides to go out and do. He travels to a place called Subiaco, and there at Subiaco, he meets a monk named Romanus. Now at this time there was monasteries that had been built and monks would gather together to live a common life of prayer and holiness together, and Romanus was one of them. And he lived in a monastery on top of a hill that overlooked a lake. And so Romanus starts to teach Benedict the art of being a hermit, teaching him how to recognize God in the silence. He even gives him use of a cave that is in the mountain below the monastery for Benedict to live in by himself. And Romanus actually takes care of Benedict. He feeds him by lowering food on a rope down the side of the cliff into the cave that Benedict lives in. So Benedict lives in this cave, being trained by Romanus, being fed by him, cared by him for 3 years. For 3 years, he lives almost completely by himself, and as a result, he's getting really close to God. He's growing in holiness. But again, people start to hear about it. They start to seek him out again as this holy, somewhat crazy guy living in the caves who is a hermit. They start to seek him out for his prayer, for his advice. Even a local monastery, not Romanus's, but a local monastery sends their monks to him because their leader, who was called the abbot, had died. And so they go to Benedict and they say, "Can you, holy hermit, come and be our new abbot?" They seek him out. Now, Benedict originally didn't want to do this because, first of all, he knew that these monks were not as hardcore as he was in pursuing holiness. They were a little bit more lax, and so he didn't know if their lives would be compatible. But Benedict was also very humble. He didn't think he was worthy to be the leader over other monks, but he reluctantly agreed after they kept asking him. But then some problems started to start because remember, Benedict was used to living a solitary life. He had lived by himself for 3 years, and he was also used to extreme penance. So he would fast a lot. He would sleep on the rocks. At one point, Benedict had been severely tempted by these lustful thoughts of a woman that he had seen, and she kept popping up in his imagination. And so, in frustration, he threw himself into a nearby thorn bush and rolled around in the thorns in order that the pain in his body would chase out all thoughts of lust. And so, Benedict was pretty extreme when it came to penance, and he started to impose this lifestyle on the monks who were under him. And these strict penances, these lifestyles of holiness that Benedict was used to, it began to grate on the nerves of the monks because they were more lax than he was. And eventually, their annoyance with Benedict turned to hatred, and they began to resent the fact that they had called him to be their abbot in the first place. And so instead of just kicking him out of the monastery, these monks decided that the best thing to do was to kill Benedict. So this just shows you the level of hatred that they had for him, what Benedict was up against. And they put poison in his cup of wine at dinner. Now, Benedict came in and he blessed the food as he was traditionally supposed to do. But when he made the sign of the cross over his cup of wine, it shattered. And he knew that they had tried to poison him. He knew that God had saved his life. And so Benedict didn't get them in trouble. He just forgave them. He forgave them for trying to kill him. He reminded them that from the very beginning he had doubted whether he was a suitable abbot for them. So we can see his humility in admitting that it was partially his fault. But then eventually he said, "Well, I have to leave the monastery. I can't be your abbot anymore." And he went back to his cave. Now, this experience was a real learning moment for Benedict because Benedict learned that not everyone can be a hermit. Not everyone can go through the extreme penances that he was used to. And this would factor into his life later when we will see he began to found other communities of monks that were growing together. He learned the value of not just being by yourself, but being able to grow in community with others. But unfortunately for Benedict, he was sought out again. Poor Benedict can't get time by himself. He was sought out again, but this time to start a monastery from scratch on his own terms, with his own rules, which he agrees to do. And he ends up founding 12 different monasteries in a short period of time. And people begin to come to him to be directed by him. Men start to come to him to learn how to be monks, to live by the rule that he has created. And parents start to send their children to study with the monks to get their education from him. And his monasteries became bright lights in the midst of all the chaos and turmoil that was happening in the empire during this time. Now, people were drawn to Benedict, yes, because of his holiness, but also because of the astounding miracles that Benedict became famous for doing. He was tapped into the supernatural life of God, and God did many wonderful miracles through him. For instance, once Benedict was having his workers, his monks, construct a new monastery, and Benedict was at a different location, but Satan came to Benedict and told him that he was going to oppose the work that Benedict was doing. He wasn't happy with him. And so he was going to attack his workers. So after he heard this from Satan, Benedict sent a message to his crew to be careful, but it was too late because a wall had collapsed during construction and had killed one of the workers, a small boy who had been working with the men. So they brought the boy's broken body. There was broken bones. He was maimed. He was dead, crushed by the wall. They brought the body to Benedict, but Benedict had everyone leave the room. They laid the body out on a table, and Benedict prayed for the boy, and he was brought back to life. So Benedict was given resurrection power by God. There was another point where the monks were again doing some construction on a new monastery, and they were trying to move this giant rock that had to be taken out of the way, but it was too big for them to carry. They couldn't move it. So they called Benedict. Benedict came over, he blessed it. And then it could easily be carried away as if it weighed nothing. So amazing miracles from Benedict. Benedict was also known to be able to read minds. At one point, he had sent his monks out on a journey. He had instructed them to fast, not to eat while they were on their journey, not to eat and receive hospitality from anyone while they were outside the monastery, but they broke the rule. They got hungry, and someone invited them in for some food, and they went in and ate. And then upon returning to the monastery, They lied to Benedict. They told him that they hadn't eaten anything at all. But Benedict wasn't fooled. He began to prophesy over them. He told them the exact place they had stopped to eat. He told them the exact foods that they had eaten, and they were forced to admit that they had lied. They asked his forgiveness, which he gave to them, and they moved on. But Benedict was a miracle worker who became renowned in the area. His following continued to grow. Monks were attracted to the rule of life that he had written for them. It was called the Rule of Saint Benedict. It became the foundation for many monasteries all the way up to our present time. And Benedict's rule of life was built on the principle of ora et labora, which is Latin for prayer and work. And God was to be found in both praying and working for Benedict's monks. So Benedict believed that the way to holiness was by talking with God in prayer, but also through experiencing God in the daily work. And so his monks would pray throughout the day, both in common and alone. They would gather together to pray, they would pray by themselves, but they would also work together. They would study together, they would do manual labor, you know, construction, all of these things. And this is a lesson that I think all of us can learn from Benedict, that yes, the Lord wants us to draw close to him in prayer, in times of adoration, through praying the rosary, through reading of scripture, but God also wants to visit us in the everyday life, in our work, whatever it is, whether it's at home or outside the home, God is there to encounter us. And this is a great lesson that we can learn from Benedict. His monks also pledged obedience to their superiors, who was seen as a father figure to the other monks. So the monks promised their obedience to Benedict, but Benedict didn't lord this over them like their boss. Rather, Benedict saw himself as a father who was serving them and loving them and teaching them how to grow in humility through this obedience. And the monks lived in poverty. They owned nothing. They wore simple clothing, ate simple food, and took care of the poor and the sick. So these monks, the Benedictine monks, as they would come to be called, became more and more widespread, and Benedict's fame and holiness began to gather jealousy amongst others. In fact, one priest, a local priest, was so jealous of Benedict that he sent him a poisoned loaf of bread as a gift to try and get Benedict out of the way. But Benedict was given supernatural knowledge from God that the bread was poisoned, and he told his pet crow to take it away. Benedict had this crow that would fly in through the window, and Benedict would give him food, and then the crow would fly away again. So Benedict gave this bread to the crow to take away. He told the crow, you know, take this away where it'll never harm anyone. But the crow protested. The crow was like making noises to him, saying, I don't want to take this bread. But Benedict assured the crow that it wouldn't hurt him. And then the crow took the bread in its mouth and flew off before returning for proper unpoisoned bread as its reward. So again, these amazing stories where Benedict is able to communicate with animals and crows are saving his life, this amazing miracle worker. Now this same priest who had tried to poison Benedict actually tried to get back at him by tempting his monks to sin. He thought, if I can't kill off Benedict, I'll convince his monks to sin and take them down from within. And so the priest actually paid for prostitutes to be sent to the monastery to seduce the monks. And Benedict was really disturbed by this, as I think all of us would be. He was disturbed by this evil, and so Benedict decided to cede to this priest. He said, you know what, me and my monks, we're going to leave. And they left the monastery and they planned to start a new monastery at a place called Monte Cassino. But while they were still on the road, the wicked priest died. He fell out of a window, and this led to some of the monks rejoicing. They told Benedict the news. They said, look, your enemy has died. But Benedict told them not to rejoice, but to mourn. This is not something that they should celebrate. And they continued to go to Monte Cassino and build a new monastery there. And Benedict eventually would end up staying at Monte Cassino, at his monastery there, teaching his monks, letting it be a sanctuary for all the poor and the sick who came as refugees. Because during this time, was something happening called the Gothic Wars. And so there was a lot of refugees that came to the monastery seeking help. The Goths who had instigated this were a Germanic tribe, and they had had conflict with Rome for some time, but they had eventually settled amongst the Romans. But racial tensions had flared up between the Goths and the native Romans, and so the Goths would eventually rise up and brutalize and raid the area. There was a lot of tension, but no matter who they were, Roman or Goth, they were welcomed at the monastery. Benedict welcomed them all, Roman and Goth alike. He helped care for the poor, he cared for the sick. In fact, he actually worked a miracle for a Goth farmer. There was a Goth farmer who had been working with a billhook, which was kind of like a machete, clearing some of his property, and the blade of the billhook flew off of the handle, and the heavy iron landed in a lake that was nearby and sank to the bottom. He could not do his work anymore. So he went to Benedict. Benedict took the handle from him, put it in the water, and the iron floated up out of the lake and reattached itself to the handle, and he returned it to the Goth farmer. So Benedict had a great love for the poor, for the Goths, for the Romans. He worked miracles for all of them. His brother monks loved him, and people of every tribe came to the monastery to seek his spiritual advice and guidance. Benedict also had a special love for his sister. He had a sister named Scholastica, and Scholastica was also a saint. She's a canonized saint. Maybe we'll do a show on her in the future. But Saint Scholastica had joined her brother and set up a community of nuns who lived nearby, and they lived under the same rule that Benedict had written. And they would visit each other, the siblings. They would pray together. They would talk about the spiritual life. They really had a close friendship. They really loved each other. And Saint Scholastica was known for working some miracles too, because Benedict was once visiting his sister, and they were talking, and it was getting late, and he needed to go back to his own monastery. He wasn't allowing any of his monks to break curfew, and he wanted to follow his own rules, so he said he needed to be going back. But Scholastica, she wanted him to stay. She wanted to keep talking with her brother, but he refused. So before he left, she bowed her head. She quietly prayed, and this terrible storm broke out so that he was unable to leave. And Benedict asked her, "What have you done?" And Scholastica told him, "I asked you to stay, and you wouldn't listen. So I asked my God, and he did listen. So now go off if you can, leave me, and return to your monastery." So, I love this sibling relationship that they have, where they are asking God to do miracles to get them to spend more time with each other. And Benedict couldn't leave the house. He ended up staying the night with his sister, and they spent more time talking. So, this beautiful relationship they had, and Benedict was well loved by everyone. He eventually died in his own monastery. He had been forewarned by God about his coming death, so he received the Eucharist right before he died. He died of a fever, and he was surrounded by his monks who were praying for him as he passed on into glory. And eventually, Benedict was buried side by side with his sister. So, if you have listened to the life of Saint Benedict, you've been inspired by him. Maybe one of the things you can do is acquire a Saint Benedict medal. This is a medal, a very famous traditional medal worn by Christians to ask for the special intercession of Saint Benedict. And Benedict is a model of leaving the noise of the world. I think that's one of the main things we can learn from him, to seek God in the silence, but also, as Benedict did with his monks, to surround yourself with other Christians who can lead you closer to God, so you can pray together, so that you can grow in holiness and become saints together. Benedict experienced God in the mundane work, but he also expected God to break out with the supernatural, working miracles. And so let's pray for the intercession of Saint Benedict right now, that we would be inspired to become saints like he was. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Saint Benedict, through your intercession, may we be able to grow closer to God in the silence. May we be able to know that you are the God who wants to encounter us in our daily work, but also that we are supposed to be called to live a supernatural life. that we worship a God of miracles. And Lord, through the intercession of Saint Benedict, may you meet us in our daily work, but also meet us in the miraculous. Saint Benedict, pray for us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.